James, thank you very much for agreeing to be interviewed for the ILSA course. So for us, what we wanted to learn more about is the point of view of somebody working for a company that provides access for live events. So can you tell us more about what you do, whether it's for intralingual or interlingual context? If you can tell us a little bit about what AI Media does and where.
Sure. So at AI Media, we provide access for all content, for live events, for university students, for people at work, for broadcast TV. And ultimately, it all comes down to the same thing, delivering a high-level service for people that require access, whether that's because they're deaf or hard of hearing or because they don't speak the language that the presentation is being delivered in. So for the majority of our time, we deliver intralingual re-speaking, and we are now moving towards delivering interlingual as well. As that grows and as that opportunity becomes more apparent and the need for it as well, in live conferencing and some broadcast areas as well.
And do you do your own training? Do you train people in-house or do you kind of outsource that part? And if you do it, do you do that like face-to-face or are you thinking about some kind of remote environment where you do that?
At the moment, it's all in-house. So we have trainers that deliver training to new re-speakers that we've recruited in classroom. So we have people come in to the room to be trained. The first stages of our process of the recruitment is all remote. And if somebody can submit their application online, their test online, and then we mark that in-house. But at the moment, everything is delivered in the room. But we are moving towards a remote training model as we scale and as we grow our operations across the Americas, the APAC region and EMEA. The need to have a faster way of recruiting and training re-speakers is apparent in English or in other languages as well. So all of our modules, as we're designing them and refining them, we're also using ways to put them online where it can be accessed and delivered from home.
And how do you go about identifying the quality of the service that you guys are providing? Is that done through kind of internal assessments? Do you use any sort of certification? How does that work for you?
So until recently, everything has been in the training program has been assessed in-house. So we have certified ourselves, NER reviewers, who review the content that the new re-speakers are producing each week. So through our initial six-week period of training, each week we have an assessment at the end of the week. That gets reviewed by the NER method. And if that person is under or over, then we assess what they need for the next week. And also through that process, we make a decision point and early identification of whether the person actually has the aptitude to reach the end of the course. And that's from a business point of view of, do we still invest in the training for this person? And also for that individual to know where they're at and whether it's actually a viable career opportunity for them. So internally within the training, as they progress through to delivering live on air, we have the continuation of our internal reviews, but we also have an independent audit on the business, on our captions for broadcast,
okay,
which is done by a professional reviewer.
Mm-hmm. Brilliant. And when it comes to certification, is that something that you've been doing for long? How do you go about it? Yeah. Is it just national, international?
So again, until recently, we'd certified internally. But more recently, we worked with the Lyrics program, which provides certification for live re-speakers in three bands. So level one, two, and three. Taking them from kind of entry level through to broadcast level, and we outsourced that certification to give us an objective view on how well our re-speakers have been trained and how well they're performing in their roles. So that's a fairly new project for us. It's something that we've started in the UK, but we're looking to roll out internationally as well, because it gives us consistency across our re-speaker pool and across our offices that says we're all certified against the same standard.
Mm-hmm. Do you see interlingual re-speaking playing an important role in this kind of scenario that we're working on? And do you see that as kind of humanly made, human intervention, or are you thinking more machine component, automatic component?
I think both, but ultimately the end product, human. Because if you look at the, if you take broadcast localization as an example for recorded media, the skill that's involved in taking Doctor Who from the BBC in the UK and localizing that for a German market is not just translation. It's what they call transcreation. So it's creating that content and that message in the country that you're playing out the recording. And I see the same thing for live, you know, because if you have a live piece of content and you're showing that in Germany, then you still want to convey the meaning of what's actually being said. It's not a case of just delivering a word-for-word translation. So I think at the moment, there's definitely benefit in integrating AI into your workflow to help you get there faster. But ultimately, I think the human piece of actually understanding the context and the cultural sensitivities of delivering a live broadcast where you don't have time to correct it is critically important, especially for broadcasters, because they want to protect the brand, the messaging, and you know we've worked with some customers in parts of the Middle East where it's really really important that the accuracy of what that brand stands for is conveyed in the live delivery. So I think with the complete artificial intelligence solution, you miss that. And the mistakes can be quite detrimental for broadcasters and their audience.
Mm-hmm. And as a final question, James, as somebody who's dealt with candidates who want to become re-speakers, who want to be trained as re-speakers and work at a professional level, what are the requirements that you're looking at? I mean, are we only looking at kind of linguistic requirements, or are you thinking some other elements are needed to become a good re-speaker?
Yeah, I think a lot of the focus and attention is placed on the linguistics, obviously, because that's a big part of the role. For us, whether it's broadcast or non-broadcast, it's also about the ability to troubleshoot on the fly, because things go wrong, tech fails, audio is bad, or you know, something happens to your Dragon profile, and you need to troubleshoot that there and then. And being able to stay calm and relaxed in that environment to get back on air and let go what's happened is a really key component for us. So it's not just about being a great linguist or coming from a background of language. I mean, one of our best library speakers in our Australian office was a stonemason for 35 years before he joined AI Media. And he just had a natural aptitude for re-speaking, loved language, and is now, you know, working as a re-speaker for us, for our broadcast and non-broadcast clients. So I think there's a lot of components that make up a re-speaker. Language and linguistics is one, but speed, quick thinking, lateral thinking, and troubleshooting are also key.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, James, because this will give our students a good idea of the skills and kind of the different backgrounds that they can have in order to get to this end point. So thank you very much, James.
No problem. Thanks.